Hi, I'm Kathleen Hirsch, and this is Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 100-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, be sure to visit our online site, Vote411, before you mark your ballot. Today we have Kate Lieber, candidate for Senate District 14. Welcome, Kate.
Thank you.
Tell us about your background and why are you running for the Oregon Senate?
You bet. Well, Kathleen, thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it. So I'm really running to stand strong against the right-wing politics that have come out of the federal government and those politics that peddle hate and fear while they're sort of systematically defunding everything that we hold dear. That was true before this pandemic, and it is certainly true now. I couldn't sit by and do nothing. So I want to tell you a little bit about myself. Is this a good time?
Yes.
So I grew up in Indiana. I was raised by a single mom after my dad died when I was about 10. One thing that you should know about me is that I was actually gay in Indiana in the 80s. And really, I know what it's like to feel powerless, and I know what it's like to feel unseen. And that powerlessness led me to my decision to go to law school, because I really didn't want anyone to feel powerless as I had felt. I went to law school. I met my now wife. We've been together for 27 years. I moved to Oregon in 1995, where I joined the district attorney's office. And I prosecuted child abuse cases, domestic violence, and some juvenile cases. After I left the DA's office, after about 13 years, I got what I consider to be one of my battle scars, which is I was diagnosed with stage 3 breast cancer. My kids were really young. It was terrifying. But I really saw our healthcare system up close and personal. And, you know, I realized that, you know, no one should be fighting to pay the bills while they're fighting for their lives. That experience and those struggles really, really have stayed with me for the last 11 years now. And I wanted to make sure that I kept that with me as I was actually fighting, breast cancer that first year. I got a call from our governor's office, and the governor asked me to serve on the Psychiatric Security Review Board. It's a board that has jurisdiction over people in the state of Oregon that are under a guilty except for insanity designation. And that really gave me a look into sort of government, local government, and it also gave me a look into our mental health system, which needs a lot of work. After I rolled off that board, I was on there, chaired it for 5 out of the 8 years. I realized that I wanted to dig in about the intersection of mental health and homelessness. So I joined Transition Projects, which is a nonprofit that works on one of our biggest issues, homelessness. And I currently chair that board as well. But truly, I am a teacher at heart. I've taught at Portland Community College in the Criminal Justice Department starting in 1998, and have taught there pretty much ever since. And I realized that, you know, being a teacher is that, you know, you don't give up on anybody. So how did I get here? Why does a teacher want to be a politician? Well, I'll tell you, Kathleen, I consider myself an accidental politician. This was not the path that I saw myself on. But the first thing that happened was 2016 happened, and I realized that we were in some trouble. But I thought we were pretty good in Oregon. We had a Democratic governor, a Democratic House, a Democratic Senate. And then the walkout happened in 2019. And I realized we were more broken than I thought. That really led me to realize that I had to do something. And what I realized I had to do was that I had to go and I had to do what I think is needed, which is to go and get something done. I think our legislature needs to think differently and act urgently. And And really all of my career, I've demonstrated a commitment to fighting for those people with less power. And it's important to bring that. And especially now with COVID-19 pandemic threatening all of us, you know, I think my district really needs what all of Oregon needs. It needs somebody to fight for them. It needs somebody to make sure that they're fighting for the working people. And it needs to make sure that we go and get things done. That's why I'm here today. That's why I think I'm the right candidate. And that's why I would ask all of these viewers for their support in my race for the Oregon State Senate.
Thank you, Kate. What steps will you take to ensure Oregonians who have been affected by the recent economic changes and layoffs will be able to find jobs and recover from what could be a potential recession?
Yeah, look, absolutely. There is going to be more difficult times coming. And you know, this crisis, this pandemic didn't create the cracks in our system. Those cracks were there. We've just highlighted them. We need to really make sure that our safety net for the workers is strong and that it lasts as long as any potential recession lasts. That's going to be really important. You know, Oregon has had to do this before in the 2008 recession, and even before that, we're in pretty good shape, but a lot of this is going to depend on, A, when this ends. I'm not sure we know what the outward bounds of this is yet. And B, it's going to depend on a lot of what happens with the federal stimulus. But what's going to be really important for Oregon is that Oregon makes sure that when that stimulus comes, it gets to the right people, and that Oregon understands where it's going, that the legislature understands where it's going, and that the legislature then fills the gaps for those people who are really at the margins. And that means the working people, that means people who have always been a paycheck away from losing their homes. And that means our small businesses, who really are the backbone of this economy and who we must make sure get back to work.
Thank you, Kate. The last two sessions of our state legislature have been very divisive, largely due to the cap and trade bill. Do you think the cap and trade concept should be abandoned? And if so, what other strategies would you support to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and address climate change?
Yeah, you know, one of the reasons that I even got into this race was because the cap and trade failed. You know, I thought I've got to do something. It's really important for me to get in there and do something. You know, but let me make an observation. We're not going to be able to save our planet until we save our democracy. The climate change we need the most is actually the climate in the Oregon State Senate right now. We need to make sure that we have accountability. And I think it's important that we hold people accountable. Really walked out at a time where we were on the verge of passing climate change legislation. We had the votes. And what's really awful about what happened was that they, you know, there's going to be walkouts, but they took what some would consider a political stunt and really turned it into them just failing to do their job. We need to look at changing the law to make sure that we either have the changing in the quorum requirements or changing the way, if people don't do their job, a way to remove them and appoint somebody else. It is really important because once that's fixed, we have to address climate change. I mean, after this pandemic, can anybody deny that science is real? Look, that's going to be one of our big existential threats right now is climate change. So we have to do it. And we can do it. And the way to really do it is to make sure that you bring people together early. Make sure that you bring both sides of whatever you're trying to pass, both sides together, and get them in on the ground floor of crafting legislation. Because if you do that and you bring people along, you're going to have a much, much better chance of passing that legislation. And quite frankly, it will be stronger legislation.
Oregon's suicide rate and incidents of domestic violence have risen sharply during the coronavirus epidemic, and gun purchases have skyrocketed. What are your thoughts on gun safety measures, such as passage of safe storage law or increased enforcement of the extreme risk protection law?
So, you know, I'm a former deputy district attorney. I prosecuted domestic violence cases. I prosecuted child abuse cases. And in fact, about 2 years ago, I lost my first cousin. She killed herself using a handgun. So this is something that is very close to my heart. You know, guns must always be inaccessible to children and teens to make sure that we prevent any risk of unintentional shootings and gun suicides. We know that weapons in the home increase that threat, and it's a public safety and a public health threat that is very real. I am a huge proponent in safe gun storage. We have to make sure that if you have guns in your home, that they're safe, that they're kept separate from, that they're kept locked, that they're kept separate from their any kind of ammunition, and that we make sure that they don't fall into the wrong hands. I also believe very strongly that we should support and increase the enforcement of the extreme risk protection orders. That is something that is going to keep Oregonians safer. But we need to enforce it. You know, no laws are good if you don't enforce them. So it's really important that we make sure that we have the resources when we're crafting any legislation, to make sure that we have the resources to make sure that we actually can enforce them. And this one will save lives.
Thank you, Kate. Thanks so much for talking with us today. Stay safe. And voters, don't forget to visit Vote 411 for personalized ballot information.